this lesson, we're going to talk about chess pie. I'll tell you what the basic ingredients are, and then we'll make a classic chess pie and a pecan pie. Let's talk about chess pie. It's one of my very favorite categories. It's super sweet, it's very southern, and a lot of people don't know exactly what it is. But if you know pecan pie and you love pecan pie, you already love chess pie. So let me back up a little bit. Chess pie is one that of which the central ingredients are eggs and sugar and butter. Sometimes there's a little bit of milk or cream in there, but mostly it's sugar, butter, eggs to make just this luscious, dense but also luxurious filling that a lot of people can't get enough of. Now, the kind that I make is eggs, sugar, and butter, but like my grandmother, like so many traditional southern cooks, and this is a southern pie, there are two odd ingredients that you wouldn't expect to find in a pie. One is cornmeal, and the other is vinegar. So the cornmeal, when you're looking for cornmeal, I want you to be careful. It's not cornstarch. You probably have cornstarch on hand. We're even going to use it in some of the other pies that we're making. But cornstarch is a very soft, delicate flour that's a thickener. That's not what you want. You want cornmeal, and there's two kinds. There's yellow cornmeal, which is widely available all over the country, and there's also white cornmeal. And they'll be much more coarse in texture. Yellow cornmeal is really almost the next thing to grits or polenta. I'm from North Carolina, and we're partial to white cornmeal, so that's what I'm using today. I brought some from a sort of home-style mill. So sugar, butter, eggs, and then cornmeal and vinegar. And as you can guess, the little bit of vinegar gives it a tangy flavor, and the cornmeal gives it a luxurious texture. It all comes together in a wonderful way. So let's get started. I've got my sugar, cornmeal, and a little bit of salt. I'm going to mix them together. And you notice I'm using the very high-tech implement, a fork. I think when people say that something is easy as pie, they're not talking about the ease of making a crust. They're talking about how often a pie is just whisked together with a couple of ingredients and quickly cooked, much easier than making a cake. I love to make cakes, but pies, a few things, and you're done. Okay, I've got my sugar, cornmeal, and salt. And now I'm going to combine eggs. I've got 3 eggs, lightly beaten. And I'm going to add a little bit of cider vinegar. You could use plain white vinegar. And a little bit of vanilla. Vanilla seems to go in almost every sweet. And I'm just going to stir those together just gently, again with my high-tech fork, and then combine that with the sugar mixture, and we're almost there, but not quite. Now, you could use a whisk, you could use an egg beater. You don't need a mixer because you don't really want to beat air into this. So I find that just a big old fork is exactly, you know, the amount of time it takes me to mix it up with a fork seems to be just exactly right, and I just really love that you can make something so complex in flavor and yet so simple to do. Everyday ingredients. Now, while I'm bringing this all together, chess pie, what a strange name. It has nothing to do with the game of chess. And there are two stories, neither of which I cotton to very much. But the first one is that two people were driving through the South and they stopped at a diner and had this wonderful pie. And they asked the waitress, what do you call this pie? And she said, well, it's just pie. And that they went home and started the rumor that it was chess pie. I don't know. Then it's the pie that's in the pie chest. And if you are fond of antiques, you're familiar with a pie safe, which is a big cabinet that people used to have in old-time kitchens. They might have a punched tin front, and in more recent times they had a screen front. It was a place to keep baked goods, especially pies, away from creatures that might invade the kitchen. And so they said, well, this was the pie that they put in the pie chest. But I think, well, wouldn't you want to put the cherry pie and the apple pie and all the other ones in there? So that doesn't make sense either. What makes sense to me is that it's an old English connection, like so many baked. So much of American baking, particularly Southern baking, comes from colonial times. And in British lore, the word cheese is used to mean anything that is that curdles. So if you're familiar with lemon curd is often called lemon cheese in the South. Not that it has dairy, not that it's made the particular way that cheese is, but it's something that is thickened up. So you see old recipes for cheese pie or cheesecake, when they don't mean cheesecake like the kind that we enjoy today, that's more of a dairy item. So I'm going to go ahead and put the butter. Now this is melted butter, and it was still kind of warm, so I didn't want to put that in while the and put it in with the eggs and take a chance of cooking the eggs at all. So I let everything get mixed together and let the melted butter cool down just a little bit. And that looked just luxurious and luscious. Okay, so that's all there is to it. I'm going to put that into my prepared unbaked pie crust. So chess pie has British roots. And as I said, you might see some with a little bit of liquid in it. If you go to Kentucky and you see transparent pie on a menu, you want to order it because it will be chess pie, usually with a little bit of cream or milk. So it'll be maybe a bit more, maybe it'll rise a little bit more, but it'll be sort of in this same family. Okay, and we're gonna put this in the oven and bake it 325 for about 45 to 50 minutes. And it's gonna puff up beautifully, and I'll put it in the oven, and then let's come back and see how it looks after it's baked. So we're talking about chess pie, and you may think you don't know what it is, but if you know what pecan pie is, and how could you not, it's so wonderful, you know what chess pie is. Pecan pie is chess pie with pecans on top. And depending on where you're from, I grew up in North Carolina from a pecan saying region, but if you say pecan, that's okay with me as long as you enjoy it and as long as you try this pie. Now, I told you that chess pie is made up mainly of eggs and butter and sugar. But the sugar is oftentimes syrup. And the syrup depends on where you were cooking in the South when these kinds of pies came along. The most common one, the oldest, is molasses pie. It wasn't called chess pie, it was called molasses pie because that was the main ingredient. And molasses is, of course, a byproduct of refining sugar. So on the way to getting brown sugar and white sugar, there are things created, and one of those wonderful things is molasses. So molasses is used a lot in baking, less now, in baking and eating and putting on biscuits in olden times. Now it's a lot less common. It's very strong flavor. I still love it, and I love to make a chess pie with molasses and black walnuts, and that just has the most wonderful old school flavor. Recommend you try it sometime. If you're from Louisiana or if you've traveled down to Cajun country, you might be familiar with pure cane syrup. So molasses is the end of the line on refining sugar. Pure cane syrup is pulled out from the sugar making process earlier on, and it's a milder flavor. It's I wouldn't say it's delicate, but it's not as intense, it's not as dark, and it's not as thick as molasses. And if you're in Cajun country, you might have gâteau de syrup, which is syrup cake, or you might have syrup pie, which is a chess pie. Eggs, butter, and sugar, and this syrup. There's also brown sugar pie, big in the South, where there's no syrup at all, but it's brown sugar instead of white sugar, butter, and eggs. So we've got molasses pie, brown sugar pie, syrup pie made with cane syrup. This one is sorghum, and sorghum is a grass. It's used as the seeds are used as a meal. The sorghum flour is very nutritious and is used a lot in gluten-free baking, and people eat sorghum as a grain. But when you grow sorghum, it looks like corn growing in the field, and people in the Appalachian Mountains still grow it to this day, and people would raise sorghum on their land, and in the early fall, cut the cane, the sorghum cane, and take it to a small mill. Oftentimes there'd be a mule going around in a circle, and they would process the entire stalk of sorghum and make this syrup, which is in the mountains often called molasses or lassie. But if people make it at home in the North Carolina mountains, you know it's sorghum, because processing sugar cane is a very laborious process. It's not something people do at home. So sorghum is something that I love to use in a pecan pie. Again, it gives it more of an old school intense flavor, and also great with black walnuts or regular walnuts. I think pecan pie became popular largely because of this kind of syrup, which is made in the States. It's a corn syrup, and there's a pecan pie recipe on the label that people have used for years and years. I have a friend who grew up in North Carolina in the country, and he remembers it called Cairo pie because it was made with Cairo syrup. Again, same deal, syrup, sugar, butter, eggs. Now, today I want to use maple syrup because maple syrup has a wonderful flavor. It's another syrup you can substitute out. If you wanted to make this pie, use molasses, use cane syrup, use sorghum, use corn syrup, use maple syrup. You could use honey. Just whichever one that you like, go for it. And before we get started, I want to tell you that I love to see a pecan pie with the whole pecan, well, with the pecan halves all decorated out, you know, when people have just laid out each one and it's beautifully displayed. But as the cook who has to cut the pie, I find those really hard to cut because you can't really get through, the pieces are raggedy. So I like to chop pecans, just sort of roughly chop them. You can buy them chopped, or I like to just coarse cut them. I still leave them pretty big. I just want to get sort of a coarse effect so that it will be easy to cut and easy to bite into. But whichever way you want to do it is wonderful. You can also, I'm going to put the pecans right into the mixture and pour them into the pie, but you could place them on the top or lay them on the top, or you could put the pecans into the pie crust. Okay, so just a coarse chop like that is all that you need. And that makes a beautiful pie. Okay, so let's put this thing together. I'm going to start with brown sugar. So you can use brown sugar, light or dark is fine. I tend to use dark, like it a little bit better, a little bit more flavor. And flour. And the flour is just going to add a little bit of thickening. Remember, we put cornmeal into the other, into the chest pie that we made. So it just gives it a little bit of texture. And I'm just going to get in here, and especially with the lumps in brown sugar, there's nothing like getting in there and pinching your way along and making sure that you get everything well combined. All right, got those mixed together. And now everything else just goes in the bowl. I've got 3 eggs beaten well. I've got that yummy maple syrup. How good is this gonna be? It's gonna be so tasty. A little bit of milk. Now remember I said no milk in Chex pie unless there is. I don't mean that it's never there, but it's a minor ingredient. Vanilla, and I'm gonna go ahead and mix these together, get them smooth, again using my magical fork. And this last ingredient over here is melted butter. And again, it's hot, the eggs are cold and could curdle. So I like to go ahead and sort of mix the eggs up with all the other ingredients so that they are, you know, just to minimize the chances that it could curdle when they get all mixed together. Don't you know that's gonna be good? Yum. So easy to mix this together. Butter going in last, and you just wanna incorporate that. Use a whisk. You could use an egg beater, or my favorite, the fork. All right, I'm gonna add my chopped pecans. You could use walnuts, black walnuts. Just mix them in, coat them with the caramelly, brown sugary, maple syrupy goodness. And let's put those into our gorgeous pie crust, which is chilled. Made this ahead of time. And I want to get every bit of goodness here. Nothing wasted when it could be pecan pie. All right. And that is it, ready to go in the oven. If you had to stop and head to the grocery store to get something you needed for supper, you could leave it like this. I put one in the fridge last week and left for a couple hours, then baked it off, and it was just fine. Not more than a couple of hours, but if you had to wait a little bit, you could. I'm gonna go put this in the oven at 350 for 45 to 55 minutes, and then when it's done, I'm gonna show you what it looks like when it comes out. And here you are, chest pie, hot out of the oven, and it puffed up a little bit. What I love about chest pie that you won't really be able to see until it's cooled down a little bit is that the top gets really crackly and crumbly, and you're gonna have this almost a crisp layer on top and then a gooey, almost lemony filling that's just so wonderful. The pecan pie has been out of the oven for a while. It's still a tiny bit warm, but we can go ahead and cut into this one. I wanna show you what it looks like. So I'm gonna just dig right into the center and make that first cut. And I am a big fan of a pie server because it's mighty hard to get that tip out otherwise. Look at that, isn't that gorgeous? Okay, we've got a nice crispy crust and that chest pie filling. So remember, butter, sugar, eggs work magic. This one is called chest pie. This is called pecan pie, but it's in that chest pie family. I wish I could cut this one for you, but it really needs to cool. It needs to be room temperature before you can cut it, otherwise it's all runny. But these are both, this is a great keeper. These are pies that you can make and they'll still be good for a day or two. I would keep them in the fridge just for food safety reasons, but when you're gonna serve them, if you do have to take them out after they've been chilled, you wanna let them come to room temperature. So be sure to take them out 45 minutes to an hour before you wanna serve them so that they'll be room temperature. They don't have to be warm. And the only thing that's missing here is vanilla ice cream or whipped cream to go with the pecan pie. Chest pie, enjoy. In the next lesson, we're gonna move to fruit pies. We're gonna make a wonderful strawberry rhubarb pie with a quick lattice top and a peach cobbler with blackberries inside.